This is Dr. Loren Launen from Keene State College, and this is a short video lecture about assembly and data quality, focusing on the question, how do you know if your assembly is any good, and why should you care? And this is going to be one module of several related modules on this topic. We're going to focus now on what exactly you should do when you first get your assembled data. So you've gotten your sequence read data back from the lab, and you figured out how to assemble it using whatever tool like you chose. We used spades in our class, but there are many, many other options. And now you have a contigs file. So what should you do next? Before you get too far into things, you should double check your data, because up until this point, you haven't been able to look at anything other A's, T's, C's, and G's, and their associated quality data. And well, generally, you know, when you send samples off to the lab, you know, what you sent off gets sequenced and that's what gets returned to you. Things can go wrong and samples can get mixed up. And so you don't want to get too far into an analysis without knowing that the thing that you're analyzing is actually your own data, and that your own data is like what you think it should be, and that you haven't actually sequenced some sort of contaminant from the lab or maybe a bunch of your own DNA that accidentally got into a sample. So one of the first things that you should do is you should verify what organism your data is from. There are different ways of doing this, but here are two approaches that have worked well in our hands at Keene State College and that I know many other people use. The first is that you can use a marker gene or even set of genes that you recover from your contigs file. And you can blast it against the NCBI database. So you get the sequence for a marker gene out of your contigs, and then you take that sequence and you use the NCBI blast function and you blast that query sequence from your data against the broader NCBI databases. So you can do that by using local blast, which we've done already in class. And what you can do is you can take your contigs file and you can make them into a blastable database. And you know how to do that. We've done that already in class. And then you go and you get a query sequence from the NCBI. And what that query sequence is up to you and the nature of your project. But one really popular one to use for anything prokaryotic is the 16S ribosomal RNA gene. And we actually did that already in class. You had a 16S gene from an E. coli, a partial gene, but nonetheless 16S, and you use that as the query sequence, and you blasted for that in a contigs file that had been made into a blast database on RON, and that was E. coli data. We did that already in class. So the 16S gene, I've talked about this before, but it's a really useful marker gene, in part because we've been using it for such a long time for that purpose. So we started getting sequence data for that gene back in the 1980s due to the work of Carl Woese, Jeffrey Fox, and Norm Pace. And therefore, there are vast and highly accurate curated databases that contain numerous 16S RNA gene sequences in them. This is facilitated by accompanying research infrastructure like really good universal primers for PCR-based approaches. It's a pretty easy gene to amplify or to find in a data set because it exists in what is called high copy number. In other words, there are often multiple 16S sequences per genome in any given prokaryotic organism. And it is highly conserved. So all creatures have it, and it should no doubt be in your data set. It's almost hard to imagine that it's not in your data set if your data set is microbial. The eukaryotic equivalent is the 18S rRNA gene, and you can do the same thing with that. So you can use that as your query, and you can follow the approach that we've already used in class to recover that the matching sequence from your contigs, and then you can NCBI blast it and see what it is, and hopefully there aren't any unpleasant surprises there. Another approach to identifying the organism that your data comes from is to use a tool called Kamer Finder. And the Kamer Finder tool is developed by the Danish Technical University Center for Genomic Epidemiology. It's online, it's super easy, It's a tool that's been developed for short read assembled genomes and also metagenomic data with an emphasis on medically relevant organisms. So it's not perfect if you're doing environmental work, but it's still, you know, can be pretty handy. It's been benchmarked against a lot of other methods. You can run raw read data on it, but it's easier to run assembled contigs on it. So that's why we're bringing it up at this stage in class when you have contigs to run. And it's easily accessible. So let me see if I can open this website for you and pull this screen out. So this is the Center for Genomic Epidemiology, Kamer Finder. You just like go there and then there's that little isolate file box. You can click on that and you can upload your contigs off your desktop. You would need to have them on your desktop in order to do that. And you wait a few minutes, you can put in your email address in and then it will tell you what you are, you know, when the search is ready. You can use all kinds of different databases here. So there's a drop-down menu that lets you pick to suit whatever, you know, makes sense for your project. This is a really, really great tool. So carrying on from there, we've talked about Kamers in class. We talked about them in the context of assembly and how Spades uses them in assembly and how many other algorithms use them in assembly. So the idea behind the Kamer Finder program is that two identical or similar genomes should have the same Kamers. So if you take, if this, you know, short golden brown sequence is the whole genome and these are formers within it, if you've got a data set of this and you compare it against an identical data set, all of these Kamers should be the same. It's not an intuitive idea, but it's been well vetted by numerous studies. So here that these boxes that are shown in this heat map across this axis are the results of a study that asked the question, are Kamers from a genome sequence going to be identical to Kamers from another identical or close genome sequence? And that is what the tight adherence of these boxes, this data along this line, are indicating, is that that premise is actually true and it does hold up. So the Kamer tool works really well as a way of getting a preliminary identification of what your data actually is. And that means, you know, if the news is good, that you carry on and you do other things and you continue to look at the quality of your genome assembly. If not, then you might need to go back to the sequencing lab and ask some questions or go back into your own lab environment and figure out what went wrong. Next, we're going to look at the subsequent stages to looking at the quality of an assembly, and that will be in another video lecture.